760-307-4075. You can also download the Station Church app, where you can watch past messages, stay up to date on upcoming events, give, and do so much more.
Here at the Station Church, we love to stay connected, and we're happy to announce we're bringing back our Connect groups. We host different groups throughout the week, so please visit our website, thestationchurch.com/groups, to find out more.
If you have kids, make sure to check out our Kids Station, where your little ones can enjoy a super fun and safe time and learn about Jesus while you get to enjoy the message.
At the end of the month, we host something that's called Pizza with the Pastors, where y'all enjoy some delicious pizza and get to learn a bit more about the mission of our church and a bit more about our pastor.
We're the Masons,
and these
are your October announcements.
Give it up one time for the Masons. How you guys feeling today? Oh, good to see you, Station Church. What a blessing it is to be in the house of the Lord. I was reminding our team this morning, we get to do this thing, huh? It's not something we have to do. It's not something that we have to check off the box. I went to church. No, we get to do this. This is a freedom. This is a privilege. And I, for one, am happy to be here. Welcome to the station. If you're new, I'd love to meet you. We've got a beautiful team of people that hang out in the lobby afterwards called the Welcome Station. And we give away free stuff there if you like free stuff. And I've got a saying that if it's free, it's me. It fits in my budget, so you can use that if you want. But we got some coffee mugs out there, notebooks, Bibles, some books teach you how to follow Jesus. We might even have tote bags now, stickers. I don't know, all sorts of free stuff. Stop by and grab something free just for coming to check us out. We like giving away free stuff. I want to just highlight a couple of the things in the video you saw there. First and foremost, we do something at the end of every month called Pizza with the Pastors. And I might be a little biased, but I like this because I get free pizza and I get to talk, and I like to talk. So if you would like to come to this, it's our opportunity to meet new friends. If you haven't been to this, we share the vision and the history of our church, and more importantly, how you can be a part of it if you would like to. We want everybody to love their church. You love your church? And if some of you didn't answer there, hopefully come to Pizza with the Pastors, then you could say amen there too. But if it's not here, we want to help you find a church you do love. How many of you guys know we have a lot of good churches in this area? We are blessed. Somebody called Southern California the Bible Belt of the West. It's the first time I heard that recently. I said, you know what, I'll take that. It's not, you know, all bad numbers and bad news. And isn't there just a bunch of fruits and nuts out there in California? You'd be like, yes, but there's some faith-filled, Jesus-following people also. Amen, anybody? You're here. That means you're part of that crew, whether you like it or not. Hey, also, I would like to encourage you, if you're not on our email newsletter, or if you'd just like to fill out a digital connection card, there's going to be a giant QR code on the screen behind me, and you can pull out your smartphone, point it at that, and you will get updates, not spam, but updates on what's going on in the life of the church. We promise not to bother you, and we don't even email every week. It's most weeks, and so how many of you get enough email already? It's like a daily battle, right? Just to delete all the garbage. So we don't want to add to that. But anyway, sign up for that if you're not already on that. How many of you guys have been enjoying our series, Solid Ground? There's like 17 of you. How many of you guys have been enjoying our series, Solid Ground? Hey, I'll take it. Even if it's forced, I'll take it. Thank you for your participation. What I've really been after is trying to teach some lessons about some practical faith, some practical Christianity. I want to recap what we've gone over so far. It's really kind of foundational. It builds upon itself. But we've been in the book of Matthew chapter 7, where Jesus taught this lesson that draws a line in the sand between those who are wise and those who are foolish. And so I don't have to ask the question, who wants to be wise? We all do, right? We just don't all necessarily do the things that make us wise. So Matthew 7, verse 24, Jesus said, therefore, anyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice, somebody say practice, practice. Puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, the winds blew, inflation came in higher than expected, unemployment wasn't going good, gas prices kept climbing, fear was on the rise, anxiety, all the things we deal with in life, right? And it blew and beat against that house. Yet, it did not fall, because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice, somebody say, not put them into practice. That was a lot of words. Good job. They are like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, the winds blew, beat against that house, and it fell with a great crash. So in this series, we're looking at how to put God's words into practice. That's the emphasis, putting things into practice. A practicing Christian is different from merely a believing Christian, right? You can believe something, but if you don't put it into practice, it's just a belief. And Jesus says this is the difference between a wise person and a fool. And some think one had faith and one didn't, but the reality is they both had faith, just in different things, right? One had faith in God's word, I'm going to put that into practice. The other had faith in their self. I don't need that, I got this. I know better, or I can figure that. I don't really, and we don't necessarily articulate that perhaps, but if we're honest, we think that. The reason we're not putting God's word into practice is because we have faith in our ability or perhaps another teaching, another system, another way of thinking. And as a reminder, we looked at this idea of building a house, which Jesus wasn't talking about building a house, right? He's talking about building your life, that your life can stand on a solid foundation when the storms come. And there's three players in this. There's the architect, and that's the one who makes the plans. How many of you know that's God? And here are the plans. There's the builder. The builder's job is to follow the plans. A good builder looks at the plans often, looks at them often. And then there's the apprentice. That's the one who learns from the builder. That's those around you. Not always, but often the younger ones around us who are looking at our model to learn how to build our lives. And if you remember, the part that I feel like rubs us the wrong way is that God doesn't build our lives, we do. You are the builder. A lot of people think, well, God will do it, right? We have this couch potato faith in America. Well, if it's God's will, he'll take care of it. And God is saying, no, 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 no. I have taken care of it. I've given you the blueprint. Now pick up a hammer and start building your life. You got to put it into practice. You can refer to, and he's not just an architect. He's like an architect who's also the mentor, the coach right there every single step of the way. The Holy Spirit reminds you what the plan is when you forget, reminds you what you ought to do when you get to a fork in the road and you're not sure, should I go left? Should I go right? Should I take the job? Should I not? Should I move to Nashville like everybody else? Or should I stay in California and put some roots down to make a difference in this state? I don't know if I'm speaking to anybody, but thus saith the Lord. No, I'm just kidding. I've heard the pushback. People go, well, what about that verse that says, unless the Lord builds the house, those that labor in vain. I'm like, yes, absolutely. Amen. But you forget about the part that says, those that labor, right? Unless God builds the house, those that labor in vain. It's this partnership, you see? Those that labor. We have to build. We have to follow the plan, put it into practice. And as we do, God builds our life. He gives us the ability to build our life. We can't do it without him. So we got to get rid of this lazy, westernized Christianity that just says, hey, if it's up to God, he'll take care of it. No, you're the builder. Amen, anybody? Why don't you put your thumb up in the air like this and go, I'm the builder. I'm the builder. I'm the builder. And the wise builder looks at the blueprint constantly. He's asking, she's asking, what does God think about this? They refer to the blueprint, what the architect's plans are for my marriage, for my finances, for my kids, for my job and my career. What's the architect's plans for my situation? And then, of course, the apprentice is the one who looks at the builder and says, I don't know, like, I'm trying to figure this thing out, and learns from the builder. If you got kids, that's the most obvious example. Perhaps you have people under you at work. Perhaps your family members are looking at your life. If you have called yourself a Jesus follower, and they are looking, whether they would admit it or not, they are looking for the example. Sometimes you've heard it said, you might be the only Bible anybody reads. Like, I can't get my family member to church. Pfft, are you kidding me? All right, don't bring them to church. Bring church to them. Hello? All right, that's not in my nose, but that was good. Today, I want to zero in on this idea of practical faith. We're getting real, we're getting cliff notes these last few weeks. We're getting simple. I want you to walk out of here today with at least one, if not two or three things. You're saying, this is what I'm going to do. Why? Because practical faith is the blueprint for a blessed life. Let me say that again. Practical faith is the blueprint for a blessed life. Here's a silly question. Who wants to have a blessed life? Everybody got their hands up. I got two and a leg. Like, of course I want to have a blessed life. But it means you got to put some things into practice to receive the blessings. Hello? God says, hey, if you will, then I will. Most of his promises in his word are conditional. He says, I will bless you. I will provide for, I will protect you. I will give you peace. And on and on and on and on. If you do your part. So today we're going to get practical so we all do our part and live that blessed life. Amen, anybody? This is not just a religious faith, right? My wife Tara, like many of you probably, grew up Catholic. And she went to Mass and yet had no idea what the Bible said. That's called a religious faith. It's not practical unless you know the plans and you put them into practice. It's simple, right? So simple, most of us don't do it. So we're getting simple in this series. There's no power in faith unless it's put into practice. There's no power in your faith unless it's put into practice. This is why Satan fights so hard to institutionalize faith. He doesn't mind a church building. He's not scared of cathedrals or nervous about state-run churches. What bothers the enemy is people who live with some practical faith, who say, God, I believe you enough to put this stuff into practice in my life. This is a real faith. You see the difference? It's a faith that is exercised in everyday life. You remember a few years ago, there was a high school football coach who would kneel down and pray after the games, and he got fired for it. That's a practical faith. That's a real faith. He said, I'm going to kneel no matter where I am. I'm going to worship God and no matter what setting I'm in. You tell me I can't do it, I'm doing it. Like, he got very practical with his faith. Side note, last year, 2022, the Supreme Court ruled that he had the right to pray on the field, setting precedent in the highest court of our nation that you don't have to give up your rights. The Constitution still stands. You have the right to kneel and to pray. Yes, even in 2023. To God be the glory. Practical faith learns and memorizes scripture. Can we get practical today? I just go to church. Like, what's she talking about? Memorize. Practical faith, you got to memorize. You got to learn it. You got to memorize. Why? Because real faith speaks out the word of God. It becomes part of conversation. It opposes fear in our life. A real faith is a faith that is put into practice. You see, fear is not for the believer. Oh man, we could just park here for like 6 to 8 weeks. Fear is not for the believer. Why? Because the Bible that I read says God did not give us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of sound mind. That doesn't mean you don't ever experience fear. It means that the spirit of fear has no place in the life of the believer, which means when you face something that's scary or causes you to get nervous, it doesn't mean, oh, like, oh man, I don't have any faith. No, it means you have the ability to overcome that thing. Sometimes you need to get a little bit weird and talk to that situation. Did you just tell me to talk? Yeah, Jesus told us to talk to inanimate objects. Speak to that mountain. Mountains don't have ears. Yeah, it's not for the mountain. Speak to that fig tree. Speak your faith out. Oh, I don't really, but I'm not feeling it. Exactly why you need to speak it out. David said, soul, you will praise God. You got to preach to yourself sometimes. If you're in a fearful, a scary situation, listen, the world is nuts. The state of Israel, they got attacked. They're getting ready to launch a counter, like they've already had, but I think it's going to be even more. And now Hezbollah is firing rockets from the north, and it's like people are asking me, "Is this the end times?" And I'm just like, "I don't know. Like it could be. It could be the beginnings of it, but also this is not the first time this has happened. It's happened many, many times before." And here's what I shared with our team this morning. Let me remind you, let me encourage you, Israel wins every single time. It doesn't make sense. They're a tiny little nation in the middle, and they're just surrounded by enemies, literally, and they've been attacked for decades upon decade, and every single time they get the victory, they win. Why? Because they are God's people. He's got a plan. You cannot defeat God's plan. How many of you think it would do Hezbollah and Hamas some good to read the Bible? Be like, as we shouldn't fight this. Excuse me, my CO. Like, have you read Revelation? Doesn't go so good. I'm gonna bow out here. But if we're honest, this stuff can be scary, right? It's crazy because Israel is not some third world nation. It's a modern. It's easy for me to see what's happening in that part of the world and go, it could happen here. It can happen here. And then immediately, a spirit of fear tries to come in, and I got to speak to that mamma jamma. And I go, no. I'm not gonna live under fear. One of the most beautiful blessings of following Jesus is living a life of peace no matter what's going on. If you don't have that this morning, that is your practical thing to do. You need to take authority over fear. Anxiety has no place in the mind of the believer. It doesn't mean you're not just going to be anxious every once in a while. It means you don't have to live there. It means you can take authority over it. It means you have victory over fear, stress, anxiety. Look, we're all human. We experience these emotions, but you don't have to be, taking prescription drugs and have all these other coping mechanisms. What you need is the Spirit of God to embolden your faith enough to say, I will not live under fear. I am a child of God. I've got the Spirit of God living on the inside of me. And my Bible says that I can speak to this fear and it's got to go. Resist the devil and he will flee. You are over this thing, not under it. Can I get an amen from anybody? Tell him we need some believers who are fearless. Especially in 2023. It doesn't mean that we're not going to face situations that are scary, but it does mean we don't have to let that spirit rule us in those situations. Practical faith has confidence. Practical faith has courage. It is bold. Faith steps out, not in the absence of fear, but despite it. We're going to read some people of faith in the Bible who stepped out in faith, and I promise you, it's not because they weren't afraid. They're human, but they chose faith over fear. Hebrews 11:1 says, now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. This is why the ancients were commended for. By faith, we understand that the universe was formed at God's command so that what is seen was not made out of what was invisible. What was visible. Hebrews 11:4, by faith, Abel. 11:5, by faith, Enoch. 11:6, without faith, it's impossible to please God because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. Who wants to live a life that pleases God? Yes, please. Well, you can't do it without faith. You can be a believer on your way to heaven living a life that doesn't please God. That kind of hurt, Josh. Why are you poking? You can be a believer, a Christian, say, I follow Jesus, but you're not living a life that pleases God. Why? Because you're not doing anything by faith. By faith, 11:7, Hebrews 11:7, by faith, Noah. 11:8, by faith, Abraham. 11:20, by faith, Isaac. 21, by faith, Jacob. 22, by faith, Joseph. Are you getting the point here? 23, by faith, Moses' parents. 29, by faith, the people passed through the Red Sea as on dry land. 11:30, by faith, the walls of Jericho fell after the army had marched around them for 7 days. 31, by faith, the prostitute Rahab. Somebody say, by faith. By faith. Say something with some faith. Say, by faith.
By faith.
That's better. Verse 32, and what more shall I say? I do not have time to tell about Gideon, Barak, Samson, and Jephthah, about David and Samuel and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice, and gained what was promised, who shut the mouths of lions, quenched the fury of the flames, and escaped the edge of the sword, whose weakness was turned to strength, and who became powerful in battle and routed foreign armies. Everybody say, by faith. You cannot be a practical Christian unless you are living by faith. So my question for you, very simply this morning, what are you doing right now by faith? Well, I believe. That's not what I asked. Belief should move us to action. What are you doing this weekend by faith? It doesn't get much more practical than this, guys. Like, this is as simple as I can make it. It may not be what you feel. Sometimes you got to say it because you're not feeling it, right? I gotta say it. Sometimes you gotta pray something by faith. You're just like, I'm done with my husband. Like, I've tried. Oh Lord Jesus, I have tried. But by faith, I'm gonna keep trying. By faith, I'm gonna keep asking God, would you change his heart? God, would you do something? I've been asking and waiting for months, for years. By faith, we keep asking. There's opportunities all around us to start something by faith, to stop something by faith. Some of you are in a relationship right now, and you feel the promptings of the Holy Spirit that's been telling you to end that relationship, but it's just casual, and it's easy, and it's comfortable, and perhaps the word of God for you today is, by faith, you need to kick him to the curb. That's not in my notes, so that's for somebody. What are you doing right now by faith? There's opportunities to get connected by faith, to stay connected. You know the enemy's always trying to keep believers separated? He's an opportunistic striker. If he can get you alone, you are vulnerable. Because you can be connected to the head, but not to the body, and he can attack you with all kinds of lies and get you thinking all sorts of weird Christian stuff. You need to be, you are commanded to be. We cannot fully be obedient to God's commands unless we are connected to the body. This is his plan for all of us. There's all kinds of opportunities to take steps of faith. Romans 1:17 in the English Standard Version, which I love, it says, the righteous shall live, how? By faith. There it is again. This is referring to the doctrine of justification, which is you don't get what you deserve. You are justified. It's just as if I'd never sinned. Like, it doesn't make sense. It's ridiculous. It's not fair. But Jesus says, I'm covering it all with my blood. I'm wiping your slate clean. You don't have to pay for your sin. It's amazing. We could park there forever. And in this doctrine of justification, it takes faith to accept that. Why? Because you know what you did. When I look in the mirror, I know my sin. I ain't going to share it all with you this morning. You're welcome. But we all sin, right? We're all imperfect. There's nobody perfect. The Bible says there's not one who is righteous. And even those who think they got it all together, they got all their ducks in a row, they think they're all that, plus a bucket of chicken, they are not even close. The Bible says their righteousness is like filthy rags compared to God's. Why? Because it's not about how good you are or how bad you are. It's all about how good Jesus is. But it requires faith to accept that. Because it's not like you get saved and then you're perfect, right? Anybody perfect in here? Anybody? Yeah. Oh, we got one. Amen. I ask you to kindly leave. You're messing up the imperfection vibe. Just kidding. I love you. We are all very aware of our shortcomings, right? We all have them. We know that this gospel message, this good news, dare I say great news, It's unreasonable. It's irrational. I am a sinner, and I know I am. But God calls us righteous. What? God looks down from heaven and doesn't see all our mess. He sees us clothed in the righteousness of his perfect Son, the only one who has never sinned, nor will he ever. He lived a perfect life so that you and I can be righteous. It takes some faith to get your mind around that, right? It's a process. By faith, we are saved. We lay hold of righteousness in our life by faith. 2 Corinthians 5:7 says, for we live by faith, not by sight. Oh, but by sight is telling me that, like, now's the time to hunker down. Like, now's the time I better order some of those, you know, disaster kits in case I get a stock up, basically MREs at the garage, and I got to get some more ammo, and I got to get the water. Because what I see is, like, stuff's going down, and, like, I'm going to be ready. Like, if that's your deal, good for you. That's awesome. But I'm saying, like, we don't just live according to sight and circumstances and rumors of wars and the Dow Jones and the economy. No, we take steps of faith based on things we don't see with our natural eyes, right? We see them through our eyes of faith. If you don't see things through eyes of faith, you're not going to take practical steps of faith, you're not going to have a practical Christianity. And let me remind you this morning, if you call yourself a Jesus follower, a Christian, historically Christians are not known for being timid. It's only like the last 20, 30 years or so where Christians became so nice. Are you a nice guy? Are you a nice gal? You find that word in the Bible anywhere? Like, what did he just say? This is offensive. Listen, I grew up in the 80s listening to Salty with flannel graphs in Sunday school, and, like, I was taught to be not. Look, we are called to be kind and to lead with love, but we're also called to be fierce, aggressive warriors. Hello, anybody? Like, you're not called to be timid. You are called to be a fighter. History paints this picture very clearly. It's only recently where nice, and we're kind of soft, if I'm honest. But you're supposed to be dangerous. You're supposed to be daring, courageous. Those people we read in Hebrews 11, did they sound like nice people to you? I know we didn't read a lot about them, but by faith, they stepped out. They faced their enemies. They defied the laws and the king of their land. They stepped into a fiery furnace. They were thrown into a den of lions. They lied to protect God's people. They did courageous, bold steps of faith that took some gumption. I'll church that up for you. Took some gumption. Why? Because you cannot play it safe and walk by faith at the same time. It's a spiritual impossibility. Because faith is stepping out according to God's word. It's not safe. Some people would say, how do you spell faith? R-I-S-K. You got to step out. So what are you doing right now by faith? When the Israelites were trapped between the wilderness and the Red Sea, nobody knew what to do. God led them out of captivity. They had a promised land on the other side. Their enemy was hot on their tail, but they had a massive barrier. Just an ocean. The Red Sea. It seemed like a no-win situation. And then God issued a command in Exodus 14. He said, tell the people to go forward. Come again? Does God know where we are? Has he seen this Red Sea in front of us? The problem was the Red Sea was kind of in their way. Would you agree? And the enemy was chasing them down, trying to get them back into slavery, because that's what he's always trying to do, get us back into our old habits, get us back into our past, get us back into our negative thinking. And God said, tell the people to go forward. Nobody wanted to go first, understandably. It seemed way too risky, way too dangerous. They're all polite all of a sudden after you. Oh, God told us to go? Yeah, you should probably do that. Yeah, get on out there. Now, according to rabbinic tradition, while the people were arguing, the leader of the tribe of Judah stepped into the Red Sea. This is cross-referencing scripture with Jewish history and tradition. The man who went first was named Nahshon. He was only named once in the whole Bible. It's safe to say this was not the only step of faith that he took, but this was the big one. This is the one that's recorded. Intellectual reasoning would have told them to surrender, to throw in the towel. Nice try, like you almost got out of there. But now there's a Red Sea, and here comes the Egyptian army. All they had to do was look for 2 seconds and go, this plan is not going to work. And some of them even thought, you know, yeah, why don't we go back? At least they got good food there. Like, this is stressful. But that is what living by faith looks like. God said, tell the people to go forward, and Nahshon runs towards the sea. Practical faith runs towards the sea. It always presses forward. It knows no retreat. Somebody say, by faith.
By faith.
Somebody say, by faith.
By faith.
Anybody want to live by faith today? Anybody want to walk by faith? Anybody want to live a life of faith? Now, here's what's interesting. 40 years later in this story, the only thing separating Israel from the promised land was the Jordan River. And God told the priest, hey, when you get to the Jordan, take a few steps into the river. He knew what Nahshon did 40 years prior. It was almost like he was saying, hey, that Nahshon guy, he just jumped in. That was awesome. Oh, and by the way, guess what happened? He dove into the sea, and the sea split into two. How many of you know the tone of the conversation of everybody else changed in an instant? They're like, no, Nahshon, what are you doing? Oh, I told you. See, I knew that would happen. Let's go. Like, because somebody took a step of faith first. When you take a step of faith, it's not just for you. It affects everybody around you, those apprentices, those co-workers, those family members. God doesn't just need you to take a step of faith for you. He needs you to live out a practical faith for the culture and the city and the neighborhood he has placed you in. For this is how he changes the world. When Christians act like Christians, when we don't just believe his word, we put it into practice. Somebody say, by faith. We got 1 point today, and it's by faith. I think you're starting to get it. I love that 40 years later, they're up against the Jordan, and God says, just take a few steps in. Just take a few steps. Human nature is to get stuck, but God would call us to take some steps today. I don't know what that looks like for you. It's different for all of us. But if we're going to live a practical faith, if we're going to put this into practice, you got to take some steps. By faith, you got to move. I want to appeal to all of God's people, wherever you are, those in the room, those watching online. You know, sometimes people watch online later, and so God's word is so powerful, it'll hit them on a Wednesday evening, and they're like, okay, I got it, Lord. Like, praise God for technology. No matter what time it is that you're hearing this, God is calling us to take some steps of faith. I want to encourage you, walk by faith. You can be hesitant, you can be apprehensive, you can have fear, but you can still take a step. Don't let that hold you. Because when you move from where you are, it doesn't just bless you. It blesses people around you. Imagine this crowd. They're all scared. They're all like, what are we going to do? What's going to happen? Like, I'm stuck, God. You ever been there? I've done everything I know to do. I've prayed. I've stood on your word. I've spoken it out. Like, I'm at my end. I don't know what to do. I am literally up against it. And God would say, just keep taking some steps. Keep going. Don't give up. A lot of people are waiting for God to do the super, and he's waiting on you to do the natural. Take some steps. I don't want to live by fear. I want to live by faith. Anybody else? I think you want the same thing. So what are you doing right now by faith? Building your life on solid ground is putting God's word into practice. And here's a definition of some practical faith for you. It means having confidence that God is good, that he's on your side, and that he's working even when you can't see it. We have faith that God's character never changes. He's good all the time. even when you're like, where are you, God? Ever been there? I was talking to somebody yesterday, and they're like, where is God? They said, I'm going to believe because I don't want to go to hell, but I'm having trouble believing he's involved in my situation. And I said, that's, you know, I appreciate the honesty, but that's not necessarily what God is looking for to please him. It's a life that trusts anyways. It's illogical if we're honest. You got to do some stuff that doesn't make sense because you have faith. And I got to be honest with you, those are oftentimes the testimonies that speak the loudest. Like, hypothetically, somebody maybe tragically gets in a car accident, hit by a drunk driver, and you lose a loved one, terrible situation. And yet, there are those, by faith, who go, you know what, I forgive that person. And everybody around goes, why? How? I would be so mad, enraged. Are you kidding me? How many of you know that's a miracle? Like, just to be able to do that requires the Holy Spirit. You can't do that on your own. Your flesh will not do that. But that story would touch so many people because it doesn't make sense. But by faith, I'm going to do it. The circumstances would say, we need to hold that person accountable to the fullest extent of the law. In fact, forget the law. I'm going to their house. I'm the law. And like, you're going down. Are you kidding me? Like, that's what the natural says, perhaps what the world says, what our flesh says. And God says, no, I want you to take some steps of faith. Practical faith means we understand God's good no matter what. And he's on our side and he's working. Some people have asked, where's God in this whole Israel conflict? God is good, he's on their side, and he's working. Can you see it like very clearly and evidently? No, not yet. Although we support a ministry that's on the ground in Israel, and I've been so encouraged. I get emails about stories of miraculous protection, how somebody was escaped, and they keep coming in. I love it. God is on the move. He is working. You don't hear that on ABC primetime, but he is working. This is a practical faith. For some of us, it's just taking a step to start speaking out faith. Speak life. You know how easy it is to be negative? We kind of come out of the box that way. All you have to do is repeat what everybody else is saying. Maybe a step of faith for you is stop complaining. Stop regurgitating the negative. Stop the worry and the fear. Speak life. That's taking a step of faith. You know, Jesus said, blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. And in our context, we think meekness means timid. But the original meaning of the word is a completely different picture. Meekness was a war horse with blinders on. Blinders on because it was focused on the battle ahead, strong and aggressive, not distracted by everything else going on. That's a different picture than timid, right? And God is saying, blessed are those who charge towards the sea. They'll inherit the earth. Blessed are those who put their blinders on to the negativity, the doom and gloom, all the fear, all the anxiety that's just constantly sent our way. Blessed are those who say, no, I'm focused on the mission and I will charge with some aggression, with some courage, and step by faith into what God is calling me to do. How many of you would realize that is a different version of perhaps Christianity that we've been sold? Like, I don't know about you, but I kind of resonate with that flavor. I identify as a bold Christian. That's what I'm trying to say. just trying to bring it home. For some, a step of faith is forgiving someone who hurt you. I'm just going to pause there for a minute because that's a lot of us. As I said earlier in that hypothetical, we've all been hurt, some of us way worse. And the enemy would love for that to be the thing that takes you out. It's not bad enough that you had the pain, but now you're ineffective as well. The way you get past that, friend, is to forgive. It's not because they deserve it, or not even because they've asked for it, but because you need it. You need to let that go in your heart. That's a very practical step of faith. And some of you need to let it go. Just learn from Elsa. Let it go. I got a 3-year-old. Don't judge. For some of you, a step of faith is to commit to a church. Can I call you out this morning? I met a guy the other night, and he was like, yeah, we go to Rhythm Church. And I was like, oh, cool, I love Rhythm. And he's like, yeah, and sometimes we do Awaken. And sometimes we do North Coast. And I was like, oh, okay, I get you. Yeah. You're a church shopper. Uh-huh. Yeah, but what you need to do is put your roots down and commit to a church. You need to put your roots down and commit to a body. Any one of those. They're great. They're all great. I like the Station Church. But I'm just saying, like, get committed to a body and stay put. Stay put. Somebody say, by faith, stay put. I got my feelings hurt. Stay put. I didn't agree with what that pastor said. Stay put. I'm going to offend you unintentionally at some point. I promise you. I'm sorry. Stay put. God says, blessed is the tree who is planted. I think that word in the original language means planted. You got to get some roots down in the soil. And then there's going to be some conflict. But it's for your good. The iron sharpens iron verse Christians love. Have you ever seen iron sharpening iron? There's some sparks flying. You know, like you only get sharper through conflict. Just because you got offended doesn't mean you should leave. It means you need to deal with why you're so offendable. Hello? Maybe God's trying to grow us up a little bit to have some thicker skin. Soft hearts, thick skin. We love people, but I ain't going to let you in and it caused bitterness and all the nasty stuff. No. Yeah, it hurt, but I forgive. I disagree, like vehemently, but I forgive you because I'm called to love. We're called to be united. All right, I'm going to move on from that one. For some of you, a step of faith is to be part of the community, not part of the crowd. You can go to a big church and be part of the crowd. It's kind of hard to be just part of the crowd here for long. That's what I love about this church. I will say unapologetically, this is the friendliest church all around. Like, you're going to make some friends here unless you like really, really, really try not to. Like, you're going to have to avoid some people for a while. Like, pretty friendly. For some of you, a step of faith is getting in a connect group. We have several connect groups. We got crafting groups. Where are the crafty people at? Got some crafters? I love you guys. I cannot relate to you at all, but I love you. Like, really? You enjoy that? Okay. We got mom walking groups. Where my mama's at? With your babies? I know you're tired. I know you are. Get some coffee and put that little kid in a stroller and go for a walk by the beach in Jesus' name. It's good for you. You build relationships. We got Bible studies. We got kingdom purpose groups. Now I've listed a few. I'm going to forget some. I'm sorry. We got a parenting group. What else? What else we got? What was that? Prayer group. Oh, yeah. We got a prayer ministry. Yeah. But that, you know, you got to be invited to that one. Sorry. it's true. we got some groups. You need to get in a group. Don't be a part of the crowd. For some, taking a step of faith is joining a team. This is how we're called to live. Jesus has called us to serve, not just consume. I hope you came in here today and were blessed by the worship, even if the drums were a little off. Like, this is mistakes made. I think I broke them. I don't know what happened. They started falling over, literally. I pray you're blessed by the worship. I pray you're blessed by the word. And you're receiving. Like, that's God's heart, is that a shepherd would feed his sheep. But can I tell you that when you get to a point where you're not just eating and consuming, but you're actually pouring into, you get even more fed? Did you know that? The Bible says that blessed are those who give. Blessed are those who serve others. May you be refreshed as you refresh others. There's this emptying out of ourselves that Jesus taught. Deny yourself, pick up your cross daily, follow him, and then you will find your life, your purpose. It's about following in Jesus' footsteps to empty yourself of your selfish desires. Like, I need to get fed. I need me, feed me. And you grow up and you go, you know what? I'm gonna feed somebody else. And we start making disciples and serving other people and not just growing by addition, but multiplication. And then the station church is not just a church of, 200-ish becomes 300-500. Oh, man, we got to start another campus. And, oh, man, we're starting to do more Bible studies in the town. Like, man, we're starting to speak faith around here and like, speak life around here. And, like, there's some negative stuff going on, and there always will be, and there's some negative people. But I saw a guy with a station church shirt, and he was just so positive and like, dang, that really helped me today. And it makes a difference in our community, do you see? This is how God's plan works. You got to become a builder, not just a believer, a practicing Christian, which means action. Simple, right? Maybe it's being baptized for some of you. We had a few people sign up last week to be baptized. We want to put you on the list to get dunked. In Jesus' name. Maybe it's just being planted to be all in. Whatever it is, God is saying, take some next steps. So, as I conclude, I will ask you again, what are you doing right now by faith? If you don't have an answer for that, take a few moments. We're going to sing one more song and ask God to show you. What would you have me do, God? I listed some. There's a whole lot of options there. And the beautiful thing about having a relationship with our Heavenly Father is that it's a relationship. So he speaks to us the thing he wants us to do. It's not the same for everybody. God's people live by faith. Amen? Somebody say by faith.
By faith.
One more time, say by faith.
By faith.
Would you pray with me? Lord, we are so grateful that you don't leave us. You promise to never forsake us. God, we want to be a people that lives by faith. We want to put your word into practice so we aren't just believing Christians, but practicing Christians, knowing that this is the difference maker between those who are foolish and those who are wise. God, I pray through your Spirit that you would speak to each and every heart within the sound of my voice, that you would prompt us. Maybe it's a person. Maybe it's a thing to do. Maybe it's getting involved at church, forgiving someone. Whatever it is, Lord, would you make that clear for us? And we, your people, want to respond in faith and say, I will do it. Yes, Lord. No more excuses. I'm not going to overthink it so that I underact. I'm not going to hyperanalyze it. By faith, I'm going to believe that it's you, that you're good, you're for me, and so I'm going to take a step. For some of you, it's a very, very small and simple thing, but for others, and you know who you are, it's a large thing, and God will make it clear to us all. So Holy Spirit, I pray you'd give us the confidence and the clarity to take those steps of faith, that we wouldn't just be believing. God, we want to grow. We want to get better. We want to change. We want to bring you glory with our lives and affect and infect this community for your kingdom's sake. And God, we realize that it takes our small steps of faith first to see your will be done. We love you. That's in your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Come on, can we praise God for how good he is this morning? Listen, by faith, I'm going to get behind those drums again and try not to mess up. But this song's a little rocking, so I encourage you to get on your feet, and we're going to go loud for the Lord this morning. Come on, listen.
Oppressor who wants to keep me in chains. I say my God is a God of freedom. No underestimate his strength. I hear the boast of a tyrant. Lunch. Let's get ready for an incredible week. Let's keep God first. Love you guys. I'll talk soon.